Good morning. It's the 14th Sunday after Pentecost. It's Grandparents' Day. It's September 11th, a day that is remembered as a day of tragedy and the beginning of fear for so many of us. But it's also a day to thank God for America, for this time we will be together, and for Jesus, our Savior. We can all echo Paul's words to Timothy when he said, "The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance that Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners." Praise God for that. Hear now this call to worship. Come before God, not leaving the world behind, but drawing it into the sacred presence. We gather on this day of remembrance to praise and pray, to mourn and repent. Come before God with your hearts open to the Holy One and your arms open to your neighbors. We gather on this day to proclaim our allegiance to God, to follow in the loving way of Jesus Christ. God alone is worthy of our ultimate loyalty. Christ alone is our Savior in this world and the world to come. Praise be to God, whose mercies are new every morning. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. For our opening hymn this morning, we're going to be echoing some of the words from 1 Timothy reading. The hymn is "Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise."
Immortal, invisible, God only wise, in light inaccessible, hid from our eyes. Most blessed, most glorious, the Ancient of Days. Almighty, victorious, thy great name we praise. Unhasting and silent as light, nor wanting nor wasting, thou rulest in might. Thy justice like mountains high soaring above, thy clouds which are fountains of goodness and love. Almighty, victorious, your great name is glorious. Almighty, victorious, your great name we praise, O Lord. To all life thou givest, the great and the small, all life thou livest, the true life of all. We blossom and flourish as leaves on the tree, and wither and perish, but naught changeth thee. Great Father of glory, your Father, thine angels adore thee, all veiling their sight, all praise we would render. Oh, help us to see, 'tis only the splendor of light hideth thee. Almighty, victorious, your grace.
Let us pray. God, you call to the lost, the least, and all who long for home. You call us when we wander from the path chosen for us and waste the gifts we have been given. God, continue to call and welcome us back to worship this day. Help us celebrate and rejoice in your presence this hour and forever. We are glad, God, to worship together this day. Amen. Our Old Testament lesson will be read to us this morning. It is from Jeremiah chapter 4, verses 11 and 12, and 22 through 28.
Chapter 4.
At that time, this people and Jerusalem will be told, "A scorching wind from the barren heights in the desert blows toward my people, but not to winnow or cleanse. A wind too strong that comes from me. Now I pronounce my judgments against them. My people are fools. They do not know me. They are senseless children. They have no understanding. They are skilled in doing evil. They know not how to do good. I looked at the earth, and it was formless and empty, and at the heavens, and their light was gone. I looked at the mountains, and they were quaking. All the hills were swaying. I looked, and there were no people. Every bird in the sky had flown away. I looked, and the fruitful land was a desert. All its towns lay in ruins before the Lord, before his fierce anger. This is what the Lord says: the whole land will be ruined, though I will not destroy it completely. Therefore the earth will mourn and the heavens above grow dark, because I have spoken and will not relent. I have decided and will not turn back."
The epistle for today comes from 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 12 through 17. "I am grateful to Christ Jesus our Lord, who has strengthened me, because he judged me faithful and appointed me to his service, even though I was formerly a blasphemer, a persecutor, and a man of violence. But I received mercy because I had acted ignorantly in unbelief, and the grace of our Lord overflowed for me with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. But for that very reason I received mercy, so that in me, as the foremost, Christ Jesus might display the utmost patience, making me an example to those who would come to believe in him for eternal life. To the King of the ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen." Our second hymn this morning is "Rescue the Perishing." That's our job. I'll be talking about that in just a little bit.
Thank you.
And now our gospel lesson, a video for Luke chapter 15, verses 1 through 10.
Now the tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to him. And the Pharisees and the scribes grumbled, saying, "This man receives sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable. What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and his neighbors, saying to them, "Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost." Just so, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp and sweep the house and seek diligently until she finds it? And when she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost." Just so, I tell you, there is joy before the angels of God over one sinner who repents.
I have stood in a place like this before on a Sunday on September 11th. I've watched things on TV, listened to things on the radio, heard songs that came from that day in 2001, but I've not talked about 9/11 from a place like this, even though I was in a place like this on that date before. But today, I'm going to. For most of us here, we remember exactly how it was that day, what we were doing when we first heard, how we watched TV for hours. We remember the stories we heard as they unfolded, and we remember how we felt hatred and fear, but even hope and pride. We remember the prayer vigils and the songs that were sung. We remember the tributes and the candles and red, white, and blue lights and pins and flags. And each year on 9/11, no matter what year it is, no matter how long it's been, we remember again. We again feel the fear and the hate, but also again, we feel the pride and the hope. And we also start saying things like, "Remember when the nation came together on 9/11? Remember how people acted differently right after that happened?" And we say, "I don't know why we don't feel that way now. Where has all that gone?" Christian fanatics, and that might not be the right word for them, but it's the word I'm using, they said, even the day after, God did this, allowed this to happen because America had fallen so far away from what God wants us to be. I don't remember those things being said 21 years ago, but I've been reading some of them this week, and I have to say, man, that's a whole new kind of stupid. Carlos Wilton said it differently. The terrorists who hijacked the three planes on 9/11 were not an overwhelming force. They were armed with not any automatic weapons, but with box cutters. But their real weapons were stealth, surprise, and the fanatical willingness to commit an act, the murder of hundreds, plus their own suicide, that the world considered so morally abhorrent as to be unimaginable. That's the truth. The terrorists did the unthinkable to people who were so unsuspecting, all in the hope that they would make America suffer. God had nothing to do with the attacks, the tragedies, the horror of that morning. God didn't have anything to do with it, except maybe he did. You've heard stories about the aftermath of 9/11. I firmly believe that God was in the aftermath, the healing, the heroes, and the changes people experienced.
Maybe you know this story about the last survivor pulled from the wreckage of the towers. Janelle Guzman McMillan wanted a change from her home in Trinidad, so she moved to New York in 1998. In order to stay in New York, McMillan knew she had to get a good, steady job. She couldn't believe it when she was hired at one of the World Trade Towers and was excited as she began her first day there on January 19, 2001. She made many friends through work, including live-in boyfriend Roger, and spent each weekend partying. On the morning of 9/11, she went to her job on the 64th floor. She and her coworkers heard a loud crash and the building moved, and then they stayed on the 64th floor until it became known what had happened. Janelle and a coworker started down one of the stairwells and made it to the 13th floor. That is when the whole building collapsed. Amazingly, steel and concrete had pinned her where she was. She was injured, but she was alive. She lay there, unable to move, rethinking her life. 27 hours after the building collapsed, she was able to push her hand through a few inches of rubble above her head and felt someone's warm hand close around hers. And then she heard a male voice say to her, "I've got you, Janelle. My name is Paul," he told her. "You're going to be okay. They're going to come and get you out soon." And she heard other voices, sirens, and a light. "They're here," Paul said. "I'm going to go and let them do their jobs and get you out." Janelle was the last survivor pulled from the World Trade Center. There were three things she promised God she would do as soon as she got out of the hospital: get baptized, marry her boyfriend Roger, and find Paul, the one who had first held her hand. On November 7th, after 6 weeks in the hospital, four surgeries, and hours of physical therapy and rehabilitation, she kept two promises she made while trapped under the rubble. She and Roger got married at City Hall, and Janelle was baptized that evening into the family of Jesus Christ. But Paul, she never found him. Who was he? No one knew, no one had ever heard of him. She called her preacher and asked him. They discussed another Paul, the one in the Bible, who was totally in the dark, like Janelle, and fought against God until he saw the light. And the reading this morning from Paul's letter to Timothy makes us see that same sort of change. Paul says he was formerly a blasphemer, a persecutor, a man of violence. Janelle wasn't any of those things, but she was unbaptized and living with a man outside marriage. Nowhere near the changes Paul underwent, but still she changed. She says this, "I was given a new life. I know that God has a bigger plan for me, and I just try to do what is right and encourage people in order to try to move forward despite the adversity in life. My faith is just growing stronger and stronger." God is in that. There were a total of 2,996 deaths, including the 19 hijackers and 2,977 victims. The victims included 246 on the four planes, from which there were no survivors, 2,606 in New York City in the towers and on the ground, and 125 at the Pentagon. Over 3,000 children lost a parent who was killed in the attacks or died in rescue operations. It is estimated that as of this year, more people not already named in the statistics that I just named, have lost their lives due to illnesses caused by the toxic fumes and dust and ash. More than 2,996 more have died since 2001. Just last week, a former member of the DEC, someone Tom worked with, died because of cancer contracted from the smoke and ash of the destruction of 9/11. How many spouses and children, now grown to adults, struggled daily because of that day? How many people's hopes and dreams died that day? We don't have numbers, but we know way too many. So where is God in those numbers? Why do bad things happen to good people? No one expected to die that day. When international trade consultant Melissa Harrington Hughes, and that name caught my attention, you can imagine, left her newlywed husband Sean to go to her office in the Twin Towers, dying was the last thing on her mind. As Moises Rivas, a chef at Windows on the World, the restaurant at the top of the North Tower, left for work, he may have been thinking about the menu he would prepare for that day, certainly not of never seeing his stepdaughter Linda or his wife again. Fire Captain Walter Hines rolled out of Ladder Company 13, but had just an inkling that this was not anything like he'd done before. He decided he better leave his wife a message just in case. Honey, it's really bad, he said. I don't know if we'll make it out. I want to tell you that I love you and I love the kids. As American Airlines Flight 77 was taking off, Barbara Olson, a Pentagon political commentator and a passenger on the ill-fated flight, may have wondered if the flight would be smooth, but never dreamed that her flight would end in a fiery inferno as the plane crashed into the Pentagon. On United Flight 175, Brian Sweeney called his wife, got the answering machine, and told her they'd been hijacked. Hopefully I'll talk to you again, but if not, have a good life. I know I'll see you again one day. He never thought that those words would be his last words to his wife. No one knew, just like we don't know. It's true. I could leave here today and not make it home. We are not promised anything. But that is not news, nor is it new. Because we read the Bible, it is increasingly clear that God's love overcomes wrath, including God's own, the kind of wrath spoken of in Jeremiah's words today. It is well for us to concentrate on this truth and admit that we don't really know why both bad things and good things happen to both bad and good people. They just do, because we have choices and we make them. All people have choices and they make them. And sometimes the choices are disastrous for ourselves and others. We learned some lessons and we shared them on September 12th and 13th and 14th of 2001. I think we sometimes forget the things we learned during that awful time, and today, let's review them. Number one, remember the uncertainty of life. Nothing's promised. I just touched on that when I talked about the people who didn't know that they would die that day. None of us knows. We forget that it's uncertain how much time we have, so we forget this next thing. Number two, make every day count. Live like we won't have tomorrow. Say the things you should be saying. Try not to say the things that you should not say. Reach out to the people that you think you should reach out to. Apologize when you should. Help when you can. Do the right thing each time. Live in such a way that you won't be sorry and have regrets if there isn't a tomorrow. Have you heard the song Until You Can't by Cody Johnson? I'm going to play it, I think, in the credits in the online version, but you can Google it when you get home or when you get a chance. It's just the latest one in a slew of songs that remind us to make every day count. Songs that remind us to make the best of each day, like Cat Stevens' The Cat's in the Cradle. Make time for the important things now. Make every day count. Three, if you can't count on tomorrow, which you can't, live like you have eternity. And pick the way you live for the eternity that you want. That statement doesn't really need a whole lot of explanation, but you know me. You have two choices, heaven or not. I can't even bring myself really to say heaven or hell. We who are blessed to know Christ, we are striving daily to get the eternity we want. But it's not a one and done sort of thing. I sometimes say this to people who are doing good things for others. That right there, I tell them, earns you feathers on your wings in heaven. I have no idea why I say that, because we are reminded over and over, if we believe in Christ and that he died for us, if we seek to him to live like him, we are headed to eternity in heaven. I have no idea really about wings and feathers and angel status, but it's certainly a good idea to not just plan on heaven, but also to pursue it. Pursue a life, live in that life, that will be so close to be the life that Jesus asks of his disciples. Love him most and love others well. And do what Jesus would do. Another way to say all of this is this way. Come to Christ now. Recommit to Christ often. It's a daily thing. And finally, four, save others. We are expected to be the 9/11 rescue squad in Morris and in New Berlin and in our neighborhoods. We should be willing and ready to tell others what we think and feel and believe and why. It's not easy to do, but if we are ever asked, we need to have a ready answer. The quick elevator speech, the quick 1-minute explanation for the hope that we have, for the reason we love Christ and for the way we honor him and praise him. It's our job to say what needs to be said for people who are looking for what we have. On 9/11/2001, EMTs, policemen, firefighters, volunteers, medical people, all kinds of people traveled to the area labeled Ground Zero, or to the Pentagon, or to the field in Shanksville, Pennsylvania. As Christians, we too are encouraged to save lives. The people who raced to the rescue on that fateful day worked relentlessly 12 to 16 hours without protection from the toxic chemicals in the air. A total of 411 emergency workers who responded to the scene at Ground Zero died as they tried to rescue people and fight fires. The New York City Police Department lost 23 officers. The Port Authority Police Department lost 37 officers. 8 emergency medical technicians and paramedics from private emergency medical services units were killed. And we can't discount the passengers who tried to thwart the hijackers on Flight 135. The famous line, "Let's roll," reminds us that there were several people on that flight who worked hard to save others right up to the bitter end. They tried their hardest to do their jobs and save others, to make a difference that day. We, who are proud to be Americans, can do no less. Our one-minute speech could be the thing that saves someone who will then seek the eternity each of us is looking for. We have a job to do, and we should be working at it, volunteering for it. And don't we want to be able to say, like Brian Sweeney, "I know I'll see you again someday." 9/11/2001 will never be forgotten. It's been 21 years since it happened, and for many of us, we remember. It's the day all of us who are 30 or older can say, "I know what I was doing when I heard about this." We remember clearly how it affected us. It's our job to remember and then make our best efforts to live just as we vowed we would live on September 11th and 12th and 13th of 2001. We need to love others like Jesus loved. We need to live as if today is the last day we have. We should make every day count. We need to be ready to save others, because we too are rescue workers in this world. We don't have badges and uniforms, but we are sent out to make disciples, and we will do our best if we love Jesus best. And rest assured, God is in that. Amen.
Let us pray. Loving God, remind us that we are here because you invite us. You seek us. Come to us and embrace us. We are here because as a shepherd seeks a lost sheep, you seek us when we are lost. As a woman searches for a lost coin, you rejoice when we are found. Teach us to give thanks. Loving Savior, we are here because we want to worship you. We want to praise you. We want to seek your forgiveness when our lives don't honor you. Help us to live our best lives, full of love for you, ready to save those who don't know you, ready to run in like an EMT, to try our best to be a disciple who looks for ways to bring more disciples to your love and care. We have concerns and we have joys. We are concerned for the people we know who need you and your healing power, healing them physically, emotionally, and mentally. We are also thankful for the many ways that our lives are blessed, and we feel your presence in our hearts and souls. In your mercy, O God, we ask you to lead us to be always thankful and to turn to you, our rock and our refuge. Gracious and loving God, we find it difficult at times to place our trust in you. Too often we look at the world and see only violence and pain, destruction, and signs of hopelessness and despair. Too often we rely on our own strength, our own plans, our own devices, rather than trusting in your hand to hold us, your love to sustain us, and your wisdom to see us through. Forgive us, Holy One. Help us turn to you when we are lost, that we might find our way home. Help us navigate the treacherous waters of this world, that we might experience your abundant grace, mercy, and love. Help us put our trust in you, that the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus may shine in our lives for all to see. We pray the prayer now that Christ taught his disciples, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Our final hymn this morning will celebrate our America, the well-known song, "My Country, 'Tis of Thee."
My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing.
And now this benediction. My friends, go into the world knowing that it is God who loves us, Christ who strengthens us, and the Holy Spirit who empowers us for service. Go in peace and joy. Amen.
Some largemouth fish in another town. You just got too much on your plate to bait and cast a line. You can always put a rain check in his hand till you can't. You can keep putting off forever with that girl whose heart you hold, swearing that you'll last someday further down the road. You can always put a diamond on her hand till you can't. If you got a chance, take it. Take it while you got a chance. If you got a dream, chase it, 'cause a dream won't chase you back. If you're gonna love somebody, hold them as long and as close as you can, till you can. There's a box of greasy parts sitting in the trunk of that 65, still waiting on you and your granddad to bring it back to life. You can always get around to fixing up that Pontiac till you can't.